What is ING? ING is a financial institution, a global financial institution of Dutch origin. Today we're going to mainly talk about the down part, ING Bank in the Netherlands. 27,000 employees, 8.2 million private customers, and around 600,000 corporate customers. And we work for CIONL. CIONL is the department which is responsible for maintaining and developing the IT systems our colleagues at the business use. The size of CIONL is approximately 2,000 employees. Around 2009, we started to apply lean in IT and starting in the IT operations. Yeah, let's call it the IT environment. And actually, what we our lessons learned we took from that time we used for lean IT, and we had much more focus on actually on the process, on how we can make the process fit to use for people and with results for end customers. A year later, we started to apply lean in our software development department, which accelerated by the introduction of agile in this field. In 2010, we started our first agile projects, and we actually immediately had quite some great results, leading to an acceleration of a lean agile rollout in 2011. And what we're trying to do since then is become a bit more lean and agile every day.
We, as IT, within our process, we had to get the customers what they wanted. We really had to change our ways to get the customers what they wanted. And one of the things we were doing, by the way we were working with a project of 9 months and even longer, is asking customers to predict the future. We are asking you, what do you want to have in a year? Tell me what you want. And tell it as exactly as possible, because otherwise we will have a problem. And this way we are asking the impossible of our clients, of our customers. So we had to change. And what we found when we started working lean agile in IT development is that when we stopped asking the impossible of our clients, we seriously were able to improve our processes. We improved our outcome by just accepting we don't know what we want in the future. Sounds familiar? Probably, yeah? Well, one of the other things we had been doing is making these huge, huge projects. And because we asked our customers to tell so long in advance what they wanted, they were thinking, well, I think I want that, and I want that. So projects even became bigger and bigger and bigger. Impossible to manage, impossible to get to the end. So one of the things we started doing as well is cutting up our project in small pieces of shippable software.
For which we basically use Scrum as the most known framework in agile world. But if you find yourself in a situation that you are cutting projects in very small chunks of value, you have to find a way to relate this value to the direction of your company. Imagine a situation where everybody starts to deliver a small piece of value. How do we know and how do we manage the fact that we should support our value stream, we should support our customer? How do you ensure that we're not just running around at wrong directions? That's by, basically, we were working with a time frame of 2 to 3 weeks of a software developing team delivering shippable software ready to show to our customer. But the shippable software should represent a bigger element. Could call it a team. This team has value in itself. This team is not not a project. This team has a marketable feature you can bring to the market and which benefits your customer. this team is can be constructed in a certain amount of epics. Epics which form together a bigger element, let's say a mobile app of a platform of a mobile app, which you basically, which takes approximately a timeline of 6 months to develop. And the thing is that if we discuss this kind of stuff with our customer and this kind of stuff with our customer, we don't ask in detail what we want. We ask on high level, what would be the direction you want to go to with this product?
What would be the value you would be looking for?
And by asking those questions and by putting it on the market every couple of weeks and every release, you basically get an early feedback on the fact if what you're putting in the market is actually helping your customer. Or maybe the ideas that you had here were wrong. So you actually are getting feedback on the product vision you're creating with each other. We're trying to have a constant PDCA of the direction of our company. Because in some environments, this is going very well. And in other environments, we're just starting to think like this. And of course, this product vision should relate to our company vision. Because having potentially shippable software ready is nice. But it's not failure yet. Software has to go into production. Now, we really encounter some issues to get software in production fast. We are a very silo-oriented organization. We grow like this. Application maintenance is hierarchically separated from application development. Our infrastructure department is a completely different department. We have a project management organization. We have a separate architecture organization. And all those people have to work together, which creates toll gates for deployments, which is hindered by manual toll gate checks instead of automated toll gate checks, which is hindered by processes and procedures. We were put in place once to actually manage the situation, but if you want to go fast, you really would like to get rid of them.
When we started working this way, we were testing about everything still manually. We're not working with automated testing at all. So, authorization's difficult, testing, everything was slowing us down.
So, and what are you doing if you find yourself in this situation? Now you go back to what you know from Lean. You solve every issue one by one. And it's literally closing the gap step by step.
So we started automated testing, little by little. We're definitely not here yet. There's a lot of testing that's still done manually that can be automated and that has to be automated. But by now, we do a lot, quite some unit testing automated. We're getting there with regression tests. We are learning to become creative in what we're doing that way. And as one surprising for many of you probably is that our people keep surprising us. I mean, they invented this great battery charger for iPhones and iPads that they recoded into a regression tool, automatic regression tool. So if you just give the people the opportunity to go ahead and use their skills and capabilities, they come up with incredible ideas.
This was an insight we got at a certain point. If you really start to develop and deploy your software as a constant flow, you start to shift from a project organization to basically a line organization, which is basically just continuous building software and adding more software to a product, and this radically could change the way you run your projects.
So, in this way, IT is helping the business to think about value more, because we're no longer in those projects and everything that's around them, but every time again, you can decide what you find most valuable, what you find most important. You finance it, the governance structure, everything is along that way of thinking. And one of the really funny things here is that this is actually really a lot of it is IT-driven. It's well received in most of the other departments, but it started within IT very much. Well, it takes two to tango. And definitely management and employees. But what happened at our company is that two first-line managers, two team leads, came together and they were thinking, okay, we should start with Lean Agile, with Scrum. And they went to senior management. They went to our CIO. And they explained what Scrum was. And I heard this story the first time by our CIO. And he was telling this to a large room. And he was saying, well, they started speaking, and I kept my mouth shut. And usually, I interrupt within 2 minutes. They got nervous because I kept my mouth shut. But I kept my mouth shut because I was very enthusiastic about their story. So what happened? Two people went there and said, we want change. And senior management said, we want change too, go for it. So we had bottom down people asking for this change, but with top down support. Support allowing them to experiment, allowing them not to get it right the first time, but still with the idea to keep it quite close, quite small. Well, as we heard in the beginning, they went a bit, it wasn't dead people, but when within the company, the employees saw what was happening in those teams that were experimenting, the fun the teams had working this way, being much more focused on creating value instead of all the other things. They became so enthusiastic that it started growing. And it grew very, very fast. It sounds very good. It was good that we had top-down, bottom-up. But we had to learn all the way through. I mean, it's not that middle management was the problem. It's just the two team leads that went there, they had a lot of colleagues. Everyone had to learn. Management in the middle had to learn. Senior management, even if they were very supportive, they had to learn and still have. We are just one step further than we were at the beginning. So everyone is, because we have to behave differently. We heard it here all the time. All our behavior has to change. So this is one of the challenges we definitely face. Well, one of the things we found is that management should give the direction. We heard it from the Obeya story you told us. Should give the direction and then give some guidance on the technical level and how far can you go for yourself, and should leave the operational level to the lower management and to the employees. Well, we were struggling there. A lot of our management was very much involved on the operational level, or was not very much seen in the operational level, but not giving this the true direction as well. So we had to learn. But what happens if you don't stay on the strategic level as management, but move towards the operational level, you get a conflict with your employees. Because people don't like them that you tell them how to do their job. So we found some struggling here and had to learn. And we took people a little bit to what we wanted them to be, paying attention to the roadmap, to the direction. And we're definitely going to try and start with Obeya when we return. Are working this way. And one of the things that we found is that it was very, very difficult for people to manage empowered teams. And it might sound as a contradiction, but what we found is that managing an empowered team means you're actually a lot closer to the team. You're there for them, you're there to answer all the questions, you're there to give direction. So this is one of the things we're really struggling with.
No, exactly. And yeah, what we really saw in the beginning is that because of the empowerment drive in our organization, management at a certain point seems to be afraid to step on a shop floor. While we, from as lean coach, we put you should be on a shop floor, you should be on a shop floor. No, we have to empower.
So where are we now? Well, we promise you we stop with the results a little bit more. Yes, we got more than 37% faster in getting in our time to market. And yes, we had some efficiency gain, and yes, we definitely reduced incidents. We also know that there are certain things we can't measure. We know that the people in the primary process, the people working on the software, that they really tell us we don't want to go back. If you go back, the best definitely consider to change their job. We also know that one of the things we can't measure is we don't know what we didn't build anymore. Because we saw with this huge project, we were building software that they thought they might need in a year, but very often was never used. We stopped doing that, but how do you measure what you don't build? So we can't quantify that, but we know that's even more important than what's standing here. But more important, one of the things we very shortly mentioned is what we got some great customer feedback, and this is customer feedback. This is the person in the street with the banking card, or actually the mobile phone by now, using our mobile app. And one of the great things that IT gives us is the opportunity to see the immediate interaction with our customers. In the app stores, they leave the comments, they tell us what doesn't work, they tell us what they want in the future. And this is definitely a department where we are really ahead in our company. But one of the things we're doing is we create a lot more transparency towards those customers. If customers complain in the App Store that something is not working, we try to reach out to them personally. So we check all the comments in the App Stores constantly if customers are having issues. They get incredibly amazed if you reach out to them. It creates a customer experience. We also, if they say, we would like to have this feature in the mobile app, we reach out to them by sending them a text message when we get that feature finished and into production. So, we do see those feedback items, and it gives us comments like, nice, someone is finally listening to me. I got a feeling, for the first time, I got a feeling a commercial company is listening to me. So we are really, really making a mind shift in this one. On the other hand, we're starting to do more experiments. We do see that it's because we got immediate customer feedback that it is possible for us to try something new, see what the feedback is, if customers use it, if they like it, and we should continue with it, or that we should stop it. This is IT-driven. And one of the things that I've been really missed last 2 days is a bit that potential, that pleasure that IT can give. So we are really, really proud of what we've been doing on the mobile app. But they are ahead. We are not there. We're struggling. How do we get that customer feedback for our other items, where there isn't that direct response? We're really, really working, because we have learned that this is the way to improve, that this motivates people. Everyone in the team, when those guys get up in the morning, they check at home what are the new comments in the App Store. We as a company, we really became found proud again when this app went live. And that during the crisis with no one liking banks. So this did something.
All of a sudden you saw IT people actually going to shop floors to look at real users to see what the feedback was on the applications they were using. For the internal customers. Now this is great, because this, if you talk about going to Gemba for an IT person, then this is your Gemba. This is where your customer are. Here are the persons who are using your application. This is great input for how you should build your stuff.
And is this working everywhere? No, because in the Netherlands, 20 minutes drive, it's already a long time. Huh? So sometimes when it's in another building, it's quite an issue to go there, but it is starting, it's growing. The concept is there, and one of the great things, the way our transformation went, bottom up, top down, but definitely with top down support, is that the top down part, or the top part, they definitely do see this. So they're trying to get this along with all the others. Okay.